Welcome. In this video, I'd like to talk about spatial information, and in the process of doing so, I'll talk about concept of a conceptual model and what that is and how we can use that in connection with our spatial information. So first of all, let's talk about what is spatial information. And basically, spatial information can be defined as any information with a direct or indirect reference to a geographical area. And if you look at some examples, you could say that the population of Copenhagen municipality is 637,936. So in this case, Copenhagen municipality is our geographical area, and the information that reference to it is the population of 637,936. Another example could be if we look at the elevation above sea level at 55.65 degrees north, 12.14 degrees east, and saying that the elevation at this point is 13.19 meters. In this case, our geographical area is given by this reference point. So it's referencing to a single location, a point in space, and giving the attribute or the property at that point. If we want to be a bit more fancy, you can use this what three words to specify that my work office is located at Reprints Harves Regency, or in Danish Omdelt Læge på Medarbejderkøb. So this what three words is a alternative to addresses. The whole of the university campus has one address, Universitetsvej 1, and therefore it can be difficult to locate somewhere within that address. Here, this three words references to anywhere within a 3 by 3 meters square using three words in basically any language. So choose your language, and then you can reference to a point or this one of these grids. Common for all of these is that they reference somewhere in space. However, we often need to reference places also in time. So we'll need to add some temporal information for a period or point in time. So for instance, we could say that the population of Copenhagen was these 637,969 at the first day of the third quarter of year 2020. So we have some temporal information. We also call this spatial temporal information. So basically, spatial information is any information that reference indirectly, as saying municipality, or directly by giving a coordinate to a geographical area. In this video and then probably the couple next, I will be using this My Favorite Painter by Peter Bruegel the Elder from 1565. This period is called the Small Ice Age in Europe. So we also have this very harsh winter landscape where the hunters have been out, well, all they caught was a fox. So a really starving situation we are in here. Anyway, this would be my reality that we'll be trying to reference our spatial information, talk about spatial information in relation to this image here. So first of all, there are two approaches to specifying what spatial information. We can use entity-based. Here, the information reference to a property of a geographic area defined by a tangible or abstract entity, such buildings and so on. So a tangible entity could be this lake here, or the building, or the tree, or a person. And the spatial information is then some property of that entity. So the species and height of the tree or the number of people skating on the ice or the use of the building. So we are representing our spatial information as properties of our entities. The other approach we call a property field based. Here, our information reference to a property of a geographic area that is in principle infinitively small, a point. So, and the idea of this, so you saw the example of the elevation at 55 degrees north and 12 degrees east. We use this type if we have some spatial information that varies continuously through space, elevation, salinity, whatever. And the thing is that when we talk about things that vary continuously, what we mean by this is that this property would have a slightly different value at even at two locations that are nearby. So if we walked about 10 meters away from where my elevation was measured before, the elevation would not be 30.19, but maybe 30.18 meters. So slight variation between locations nearby. In that case, so something that varies, where basically we have new values everywhere, that we will use a property field-based representation. If we now look closer at what we mean, these entity-based representations. The concept is really that not an entity, that's not our building element. Our building element is really what we will call an entity type. So we will decide that we want to reference or have our spatial information reference the lakes. So we have an entity type referencing all the lakes, all the buildings. And common for that entity type is that we have to define the lake in the same way. So we need to use the same rule for defining each of all the lakes, all the trees, all the buildings. And each entity of a type must also carry the same properties. So if we register that how many people are skating on this lake, we also do it for that lake and that lake and that lake. And sometimes there's no one skating. So we have, and if we register the species and the height of the tree, we'll register the species and height for all of the trees, and maybe sometimes we can't distinguish which species it is. So a property, or sorry, an entity type or entity class is a series of entities that are defined by the same rules and carry the same properties. When we talk about how to represent these, they are typically represented as points, lines, or polygons in two, three, or four dimensions. So, two dimensions, that is an X and a Y, and so an latitude and longitude. The Z is typically the elevation, so the Z value of this bird might be 30 meters. Or the set value of the mountain might be 100, 200 meters. I don't know. Also, we use the T, so the time. So we, at one time, this person is here. At a later time, this person might have moved. So our data is typically represented in two, three, or four dimensions. Of course, most of our visualizations will only be in two dimensions. So the printed map or a visualization on the screen are, of course, only two-dimensional. But the data, the spatial information that we have stored, is in two, three, or four dimensions. There are basically two different approaches to these entity types. We can have tangible entities, buildings, trees, and so on. And typically, they will have everyday names, a building, a tree. But what we have to be aware of is that when we talk about information science, we try to avoid too much of uncertainty. So we need a relatively precise definition. Sometimes these definitions can become a wee bit counterintuitive. For instance, in the most common Danish data set, the Denmark data set, we have that a forest is still a forest, even if there's no trees, because all the trees have been harvested, as long as we expect new trees to be planted to grow up. So we can have a forest without any trees. Or what really constitutes a building? Can a underground parking lot under a public square, so where all of it is underground, can that be a building? Just a submerged subsurface building? Is that still a building? And is the public square then the roof of that building? So you often have to think carefully about what we mean with these definitions and how we can make them function in a way that is suitable for storing our spatial information. The properties of our entities, so the thing that is carrying the information, so has to describe the entity as a whole. So we can talk about how many people are skating on the ice on this lake, but it won't make sense to have a property that describes the thickness of the ice here and there and there and there, because that will not be describing it as a whole. We can talk about the minimum ice thickness and the maximum. That will still be describing the entity as a whole. So when we talk about properties describing entities, they describe the entity as a whole, not the entity and some given point within the entity. We also talk about the entities as atomistic, meaning you cannot subdivide them, or holistic, as we see them as one. There's also those entity types that are abstract, not tangible. And there's basically two types of them. There's those that are defined by classification. So we have some property, elevation. If the elevation is more than 300 feet, you can call it a mountain. So different systems that where we take a property, be it elevation, salinity, whatever, and classify that property to create a series of entities. So we also say that we partition the space into entities using this classification. Partition means break into parts. So we take a classification system, apply it to a property, and then that generates a series of entities that covers the entire space. A simple example would be salinity. So we could classify water bodies according to their salinity, specified in parts per thousand. So if there is less than 0.5 parts per thousand of salt in the water, we call it fresh water. From 0.5 to 30 parts per thousand, we call it brackish water, so all the fjords, so on. And from 30 to 50 parts per thousand, we call it saline water. So here we'll find most of the ocean waters. So here we could classify water bodies according to a single attribute, namely salinity. Or we could have a more complex example. This is the classical soil diagram, where we classify soil according to the percentage of clay, silt, and sand of each fraction. And if there's more than 30% of 55% clay and less than 40 and whatever, we call it the clay soil or sand soil, and so on. So again here, our units, our soil units, are not tangible entities. They are entities that are created by applying a classification system to another property. Another type of abstract entities are entities defined by definition. So we could say a municipality. No, there's no classification or measurement of anything we can go out and do that would define what is the borders of Copenhagen municipality. That is a political decision, given with some heuristic definitions on it. Same goes for country or cadastral units. So they are all things that are defined by some definition that is typically arise through a political discussion. There are also some that are difficult to delimit, such as Europe. What is really, where is the borders of Europe? Is it the continental plate? What is it? Or in Danish, we talk about ghettos. So areas with more than 50% of people of non-Western origins. But how 50%, how can we then do? I mean, if you just divide it large enough, it's, you know, where would be that? So it's a question about how do we, it's not always as simple as you might think to define these borders. Finally, there are those that are mathematically defined, as basically statistical grids. So instead of having statistics on municipalities, you could have statistics on 10 by 10 kilometers or 100 by 100 kilometers or 100 by 100 meters. Or we can use this three word grid, which is a 3 by 3 meter. So the whole world is defined into small 3 by 3 meter grids. And then we use this what three words reference system to reference to each of these grids. So enough about our entity type. If we look at our property fields, so we had, again, we talked about it as something that is continuous. I have isocurves indicating this landscape here. Could be elevation of it. It could be air pressure, temperature, whatever. So properties in space that vary continuously are typically represented as property fields. There's another type of these property fields that is often met, which are property fields that arrive from analyzing some other data. In this case, I have a lot of addresses in a ghetto in Denmark, and each of these dots have a different color according to how many times a crime has been registered at this dot. And then this green to red background indicates the density. So within a specific area, we have counted out how many crime are registered. So not in the individual point, but the density of an area. So densities, probabilities, quite a lot of functions that we can generate from point data to a property field. So this is a very common way of doing it. So, if we take a bit deeper dive into this, and you want to say, okay, I've given you the basics of it, I've given you an overview of what is spatial information and what is a conceptual model. If a going further, we can look at, I've got some other videos here, so we can talk more about how we design this conceptual model. We also sometimes call it our ontology. Ontology meaning what really exists. So we can see that in one of these videos. Also a video about how we represent this as digital data. So, and the conceptual model is a analog. So there's lots of abstractions that we have not done in here before going to the digital layer. And there's also a video to watch on that. And then finally, once we have our digital model, we need to store it physically on some computer storage. So this is what we call our physical model. And that how we implement these physical models depends on what system we are using. Is it Postgres? Is it ArcGIS Pro? Is it QGIS? Whatever it is. So in all of my videos about these different software packages, there will be videos about the physical storage of it. There's a video on how we do this if we have data stored in ArcGIS Online. So I hope you liked the video. I hope to see you in one of those other videos. And basically, bye.